Sarianna with gynecological point of view. Then we talk about the anesthesiological point of view. And last but not the least, Daniele with the neonatological point of view.
Okay.
I'm sorry if I talk about the theory of the obstetric emergency. I try to go fast and skip to the case. I talk about the little introduction in Italy about the maternal dip. The hypertensive disorders in pregnancy, and then we have a case one, the postpartum hemorrhage, shoulder dystocia, very little, and then the case two, and then we have the, we can watch the video. We know that maternal mortality in Europe is a major marker of health system performance, and every year in Europe we have from 300 till 1,000 women die for pregnancy or delivery. In Italy, every year we have 9 deaths every 100,000 babies born, and the main cause of death is hemorrhage. Followed by gestational hypertensive disorders or embolism. So it is very important to make a review of the case in order to try to prevent the emergency and avoid it. These are the our cases in Italy of maternal death from 2013 and 2016. We had 88 deaths. This means 8, so it's similar to the Europe trend. 8 every 100,000 babies born. The main cause is the postpartum hemorrhage. For the second cause, we have the sepsis, so the infections of the genital tract, the hypertensive disorders, and the problem with coagulation, and the last neurological cause. I want to say something that probably you already know. Something about the monitoring is important to understand. Sorry. No, far a mettere in sala d'attesa. Okay. No. To understand how the fetal health ray tracing is not very well, because we have to make a decision early in order to avoid ischemia, hypoxemia, hypoxia, and asphyxia. With fetal in particular, it's important to know the category 3 of an abnormal partner in the fetal heart rate tracing, and we have to perform an immediate delivery in case of absent variability plus recurrent deceleration over 20 minutes or recurrent variable deceleration over 20 minutes or in presence of bradycardia lasting more than 10 minutes or in case of sinusoidal pattern. About hypertensive disorders in pregnancy, we can have preeclampsia, eclampsia, or HELLP syndrome, that is the real emergency, or we can have gestational hypertension, chronic hypertension, or preeclampsia superimposed on chronic hypertension. A few words about preeclampsia. The clinical presentation of that can be with persistent or severe headache, visual abnormal, abnormalities, abdominal pain, epigastric pain or retrosternal pain. We can also have patients with altered mental status or dyspnea or tachypnea. So we have to think about, because sometimes it's not so clear the presentation of the preeclampsia in women. So we have to think about. So accurate assessment of blood pressure is mandatory. Laboratory test to check platelets, renal function and liver function, to check the fetal status and the neurological status of patients. We do usually this test that I don't know if you use it, is Alexis, is a test where we check the angiogenetic factors, and this test can allow to us to understand if the situation is worsening or not, and the time of preventability of this test is 1 week. I mean, if the test is positive, we can wait a condition that can worsening. The medical management use antihypertensive drugs, oral nifedipine, labetalol, or alpha methyl dopa. No, I think every one of us know these drugs and usually use. We use magnesium sulfate in case of very preterm babies to protect the neurological part of the babies, or in case of emergency hypertension to control the pressure of the patients. And maybe we can also see this during the case. It's also important the fluid balance and volume expansions in that patients. Eclampsia, it's a real obstetric emergency, and we can have eclampsia in patients who has hypertension, headache, visual disturbances, or epigastric pain, or also asymptomatic. Generally, the eclampsia is manifested by a tonic-clonic seizure. We can have, after that, a fetal bradycardia for at least 3 to 5 minutes. We can have reduced variability, sometimes transient accelerations, so we have to wait. What we have to do first: maternal oxygenation and protection for trauma, establish an adequate intravenous access. The preventions of the recurrent seizure is with magnesium sulfate, and eventually in the second time diazepam. Treat the hypertension with the therapy, with the drugs. And only after maternal stabilization, consider the delivery. We also can have a HELLP syndrome, that is a syndrome characterized by hemolysis with microangiopathic blood smear, elevated liver enzymes, and a low platelet count. Usually HELLP syndrome presents with a rapid onset and they progressively worsen. We can see schistocyte, the high level of bilirubin, low serum haptoglobin or LDH, higher, elevated liver enzymes, and low platelets. So this is the advice to manage the HELLP syndrome from up to date. And I want to only say, because I think you know very well this, but what is very important is consider the liver after maternal stabilization. And the case that I have is a patient of 31 gestational week, first pregnancy. She was admitted on 21st of April. She had bilateral notches of the uterine arteries. In the anamnesis, she has she had the gestational hypothyroidism, a mutation of the factor 2 of the coagulation, prothrombin. And she was admitted for elevated blood pressure. She was already taking therapy, alpha-methyl-DOPA, twice a day, and levothyroxine and aspirin. On the morning of the 1st May, she complained of reduction of fetal movements, but she had an ultrasound and cardiotocography that were normal. My colleagues didn't repeat the exam because the exams of the day before were batteria quasi scarica, normal, or at least more or less normal, because she had a low, lower count of platelets, normal transaminase, and she had 1.4 gram of protein 24 hours. In the evening of the same day, at during the night at 11 p.m. Patients complaints epigastric complaint, epigastric pain, and the blood pressure was high but not so high. We had a cardiotocography in the afternoon that was normal, and my colleague decided to perform a cesarean section. But when she came on the delivery room, we didn't found, we didn't record the fetal heart rate, so the baby was dead. We performed a cesarean section for the suspected abruptio placenta, and indeed she had. This was the uterus of the woman. And we ask for the blood exam during the night, so just before enter to the delivery room. And those was this was the exam. She had a lower count of platelet, and creatininemia was higher. Transaminase still normal. So what we found in the placenta, she had an hematoma, so it was an abruptio placenta with a residual vasculopathy and a villus mal development, so as with accelerated maturation. She had also intervillus thrombus and chronic villitis. So there was the abnormalities in the vascular maternal plate. If you have question, please tell me. But if you can also write to the, in the chat.
Maybe, I don't know, did you do the S-fleet to PLGF ratio in this woman?
If we do, sorry, if we do?
That test that you were saying about the S-fleet PLGF?
No, No, because this, no, they didn't do.
Okay, thank you.
We have sports, we have one head, but two words with different meaning. So I was there during the night, but I work in the other world. I don't know if you can understand the management of our hospital. And they didn't ask, unluckily. Because I think it could be important in order to at least repeat the exam that day, because we had the call on the 1st of May, I think. And she complained something, so maybe we can avoid the fetal diff, maybe.
It was just for curiosity, because I don't know. I mean, these cases can happen anytime. We know they can happen without any, and there is no evidence in the literature.
Did you see the womb, the uterus?
Yes, horrible. This is we call it like Kugler sign.
Yeah, yeah. So it's impossible. Horrible. With the pressure of 145 out 95, it's unbelievable. No.
Yeah. Yeah.
Something is wrong. I cannot understand. I think she had a high hypertension and we didn't check, or I don't know, because the last exams, this exam that we can see, I ask, please do the exam in order to understand what was happening. But I thought it was worse than this.
Yeah. Some women just tolerate very well this coagulopathies, or what leads to coagulopathy, and they don't have signs. It just happens. They tolerate well. The clinic is not too bad.
Not too bad,
but they are very bad.
Yes, and she was also taking aspirin, so strange. Aspetta, mi avevano scritto. Sorry. Aspetta, da dove lo prendo? Sì. Ma se me lo indichi là, non vedo. Ah. You wrote, sorry, because. And now. Okay. Zoom. And about postpartum hemorrhage, we know that we need to have a blood loss higher than 500 millimeters after vaginal birth, or 1 liter after cesarean delivery. The main causes are named with the 4 T's, and I mean the tone, trauma, tissue, thrombin. This is the cause that can explain the postpartum hemorrhage. So we have to check there. In the uterine atony, in the trauma, in the laceration, the rupture of the uterus, in the tissues, I mean the retained products of the placenta, or if these are excluded, with the cause in the coagulation. We have risk factors as multiple pregnancy, a previous hemorrhage, postpartum hemorrhage, the preeclampsia, or the hypertension, a birth weight, a baby born with a weight of higher than 4 kilos, or second or third stage of labor longer than the normal. We consider severe the hemorrhage when we lost more than 1 liter and a half. The basic interventions are anticipated based on risk factors, because if we are prepared, we can face better the situation. Call for help, monitoring continuously the vital sign and the blood loss, establish adequate intravenous access and therapy, establish the etiology with the four T's, do the uterine massage, give to the patient uterotonic agents, and tamponade or uterine packing, and replace uterus if we have inversion of the uterus. That could be also a cause of hemorrhage. So we can perform a curettage if we have retained placental products, repair laceration, or proceed with uterine compression sutures. We have also the arterial ligation, and finally the hysterectomy or pelvic arterial embolization if in your ward is possible, because in our hospital we have a radiology in another place, so we cannot move patients if she is not stable. We can only plan the arterial embolization if we know that patient could has the risk, for example, for percreta placenta, so we can perform before she had cesarean section, for example. A few words about shoulder dystocia, because then there is the case. You know that is a real obstetric emergency, and where the shoulder is blocked, and we don't have a lot of time because the fetal pH will drop by 0.01 till 0.02 units per minute. It's important to have done an episiotomy before this delivery, to have a distended bladder. And then we have to start with the maneuvers. Macrober and suprapubic pressure first, and then the Rubin, that are the international maneuvers. Rubin with the rotation of the shoulder, and Woods. But finally, we know that at least but the major part of the shoulder dystocia is resolved by the delivery of the posterior arm of the Jacquemier maneuver. We also have these maneuvers, I hope don't do in my life. Clavicular, for example, the clavicular fracture when the previous maneuvers doesn't work. We also have Zavanelli, as I don't want to think about that. The case is that it's the patient, 24 years old. She was an outpatient, and she came for the first time to our hospital at 37 gestational week. She had a previous delivery some years before, with a vaginal birth of a male of 4 kilos, and she also had two ectopic pregnancy with left and right salpingectomy and a miscarriage. So that pregnancy was obtained by IVF, and also this pregnancy was obtained by IVF, in vitro fecundation with ICSI. She presented during this pregnancy diabetes treated with diet. And she had a fetal scan at 35 gestational week with a fetal weight estimated at 3 kilos, 600.
so higher than 95th percentile. And she gained 4 kilos during pregnancy. She was admitted at 38 gestational week for labor induction, even if she had a gestational diabetes treated by diet. We decided that for the weight of the baby at 36 weeks. We start vaginal prostaglandin on day 24 and 25. On day 26, no, without any results, because she had, after the first vaginal prostaglandin, uterine tap systole. So we stopped, and then the day before we try again, but she didn't have contractions. So the day before, the third day of induction, my colleague tried with oxytocin for a few hours without result, and they stopped. On the 27th of August, I performed a rupture of the amniotic sac and I put oxytocin. She started to have regular contractions from the 2 of the afternoon. She had epidural in the afternoon at 4, 5, and she had a complete dilatation at 6:20 in the evening. Wait. Okay, complete dilatation at 6 in the evening. At 8 p.m., we have a birth of male, 4 kilo 900, with a normal apgar. I did the McRoberts maneuvers and suprapubic pressure. We didn't perform episiotomy, but she had a first degree perineal laceration, and she had blood loss of 100 milliliters. At 10 p.m., patient start to complain pelvic pain. She had normal lochia. My colleagues give to her paracetamol. And 30 minutes after, she had hypotension with frequency of 105 per minute. But the uterus was contracted, she had normal lochia, but progressive pain and anemization. So they decided to underwent laparotomy to understand what was happening. They found hemoperitoneum, uterine rupture in the left lower segment with uncontrollable bleeding, supracervical hysterectomy was performed, and she had blood transfusions. So, do you think it is correct admission at 38 gestational week?
I guess for diabetes that seems uncontrolled in terms of the weight gain of the baby, yes. So we actually induce them, if they are diet controlled and properly diet controlled and everything is good, the weight of the baby is normal, we induce them at 39. But if the diabetes is not well controlled, either by measuring the glycemias or by the looking at the weight of the baby, we would admit at 38 and induce.
The glycemia was abnormal only in the morning. But she had a diabetic check the day before coming to the hospital, and they didn't change. They only give some advices with the breakfast. Try to eat this and this. So I also think about I thought that it was diabetes controlled, I thought, but probably not, it wasn't. I ask you, do you do you think it was right to repeat an ultrasound? I didn't do.
Actually, what I know from the literature and what we actually, we don't really repeat the ultrasound because you cannot rely on the birth weight. It could have been, you could have got 4 kilos, 200. Yeah. So it's not very reliable, the ultrasound, for estimation of the birth weight.
Yeah.
And I would not have planned a cesarean section for this woman.
No. No, for me. I thought exactly the same, but I think I made a mistake because I think it was wrong. Wrong, but maybe not. Come si dice?
Non preventable.
Preventable.
Yes. And we cannot know. We cannot know in advance.
Mm. And what do you think happened? I think with the in the moment of delivery, maybe the baby with the arm had broken the uterus, passing to the. I thought that. Also because she had the last question, do you think pre-existing uterine scars are risk factors, for example, ectopic pregnancy?
Maybe if they do something for IVF, I don't know, endometrial scarring or I don't know.
Well, I checked on the literature and I found that ectopic salpingectomy could be a risk for uterine rupture, but you know the rupture was in the lower part of the uterus, not high. So I don't know.
Very, very interesting case. Really, really interesting. And what did you find in the after you it was easy to solve the hemorrhage? Everything went well?
Yes, she had a problem because during the hysterectomy it was a really mess, and she had a problem with the ureter. So in the day after, two days after the laparotomy, she started to have a fever and abdominal pain, and we found urine in the abdomen. So she needs to put a catheter in the ureter, and she had a prolonged admission to the hospital. And then as she needed to have antibiotics, she also presented a thrombosis in the arm. So she wasn't happy. She wasn't really happy. That's all. But now she is well. I check this week because this delivery was on 2018. And now I have seen she has diabetes.
Hmm. It happens very often now after you get gestational diabetes screening positive in pregnancy, they develop. But very, very, very soon for her. Maybe she was obese or I don't know. Very interesting case. Very, very interesting. We have a lot of cases like we have cases like this. And actually, it is very, very, very difficult to really solve obstetrical emergencies completely safe. It is very difficult.
Yes.
Because we don't have training in that. I mean, you have to be very old to have seen it all, to know how, to have a lot of experience. I don't know.
Yes. Difficult work. I put this to check the fetal biometry, no? Because at 30, I was wondering, I needed to repeat the ultrasound. Yes, no, you can see at 36, it was 3,600. If I repeat, or what can I expect at 38? 4 kilos, 4 kilos, so 200. I really, expected 4 kilos, 300, 4 kilos, a little bit more than the first son, daughter, you know, because she has a daughter, a son.
So,
ha una domanda? Sì. Yes, during the emergency, obstetrical emergency, we do sopra cervical hysterectomy, yes. Because it's not easy to understand the situation. I think I didn't see, but I well remember the face of my colleagues the morning after. And what about management of obstetric emergencies at maternity center? It's important sharing multidisciplinary procedures, to have protocols, to use medical and surgical monitoring and alert system, MEOS, to have devices in the delivery room, and to have a standardized communication, and if possible, multidisciplinary simulations. And that's all.
Thank you very much. Can I ask something?
Sí. Yes.
How do you plan? How do you plan when you have placental adherent placenta? When you know that you have a patient with probably previous cesarean sections that is diagnosed by ultrasound or with a high suspicion of adherent placenta, whether is it accreta or maybe even percreta.
If we have accreta, percreta, in that case, what do you do?
Yes, how is your plan of management? What do you do?
We ask the RMI to a better diagnosis, and if we have high suspicion, we organize in the operating theater. We ask to radiologists to put a catheter in order to perform the embolization, so they can come, they put the day before the catheter, and then if we need, they can come to inject a solution. We have blood, a lot of blood. We perform an incision of the uterus sul fondo, fundus of the womb, and we extract the baby from there. We keep inside the placenta. We didn't try to, if we know it, that is percreta, and we start with the hysterectomy. If we are not sure that placenta is percreta, we try to keep the placenta. We try.
Thank you. We had some cases where we left the placenta inside for many, many weeks. They didn't require, some required secondary hysterectomy, and others, the placentas just disappeared. In 2-3 months, it went away.
But with embolization or without?
Without.
Because with the fertilization is more quickly.
We don't have, unfortunately, we don't have embolization in our hospital.
Don't have.
No. But did you have patients where you left the placenta in situ and you follow them for many, many weeks and then it resolves? Or do they more often get to hysterectomy?
We don't have a lot of cases of that, but I remember a patient that said that had a delivery in another hospital and she came here with a placenta inside. And we perform embolization and we wait. We also used methotrexate. Do you use it? Methotrexate?
No, we didn't use it. No.
Okay, we use it in order to have a quickly die of the placenta and then we keep it, the placenta. But we keep the patients admitted. But not months, days, weeks, no months.
Yeah. No, we see a lot of cases now because we have, I think, one of the highest rates of cesarean sections in the European Union, around 50%. So we see cases. And unfortunately, there is no center dedicated to take them and completely prepared to take them. But we'll see. This will be the next step. Thank you very much. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Quasi, sai, è arrivato Eric.
Dai,
okay, bravissima, prendi fiato, brava. Ecco qui, Eric, 19.
Auguri. Auguri.
Questo qua, cara, guardi, glielo metto qua sulla pancia, che così magari
bene.
Un po' di contatto pelle a pelle. Ecco qua. Lei, papà, può tenerlo così, guardi. Oh, bravissimo.
Bene.
Ok, come fai dei bei respiri, sai? Ci stai, hai partorito. Ok,
respiri.
Allora, prendete la
poi per il secondamento, certo.
Ok, le perdite quanto sono?
Le perdite quanto
sono?
Ok, dottoressa, mi sente se il dottore contratto?
Arrivo.
Mi fa un po' fatica, per favore portate l'ecografo.
Ok, qualcuno che ci porti l'ecografo.
Chiamiamo l'anestesista, prendiamo una vena.
La placenta.
Allora, dottoressa,
se non ce l'ha, grazie.
19-12.
Aumentiamo anche l'ossitocina. L'ossitocina, sì, non si preoccupi, è tutto nella norma.
Allora, io intanto
aumenta l'ossitocina altre 10 unità, grazie.
Sì, la faccia le 10 unità intramuscolo.
A posto.
L'utero è contratto?
Controlliamo i genitali.
No, non è contratto. Ok, continua a massaggiare.
Ok,
la placenta.
Stai tranquilla, ok.
Si sta soffrendo.
Assecondato, sì. Fai dei bei respiri, ok.
Libera, prendiamo delle valve e controlliamo.
Ok. Sì, cara, stai tranquilla, sai? Stai tranquilla, ok.
Ordiniamo il sangue.
Sì.
Chiamo per il sangue.
Sì.
Sì,
l'utero non è contratto?
A volte capita, sai, guarda papà, ti chiedo
ho
una
chiesto
cosa,
due sacche
te lo passo io, okay.
Si può sedere papà che ci lascia lavorare un attimo? Si mette sulla poltrona.
Le valve?
Sì, prego, si accomodi.
Controlliamo il
mettiamo il Naladol.
Sì,
preparo il Naladol.
Valve.
Allora, i genitali
di Tranex,
sì, perfetto.
Okay, i genitali sono integri.
Sì, sono a posto, l'utero a posto, bisogna continuiamo a massaggiare.
Okay.
Il collo mi sembra a posto.
Ok, perfetto. L'utero non è contratto. Che dice di mettere il Bacri? Fai dei bei respiri.
Fai dei bei respiri.
Ti passa tutto.
90 su 40. Sì, grazie. Un grammo.
Dottoressa,
sì.
Ci dà le indicazioni. L'utero è contratto.
Mettiamo il Bacri.
Ma, aspetta un attimo, deve fare lì. Com'è l'emoglobina? Perché qua continua a perdere.
Partiva da 10.
Allora, partiamo con il Bacri, vai.
Ok.
Metti tu.
Ma che sei lì? Dottore?
No.
Allora, cara, stai tranquilla. Aspetta.
Ok.
Aspetta. Ok, la signora è stata trasferita in sala e adesso aspetta che la seda
sì,
che dia l'ok per mettere il Bacri.
Assolutamente.
Tanto massaggio l'utero.
A quanto sono le perdite? 2.500 di perdite.
Dottore, possiamo andare col Bacri?
Possiamo
andare. Ok. Sangue.
Inserisco. Perfetto. Gonfia pure, libera.
Ok.
Perfetto. Quanto hai messo?
Ok. Fammi controllare con l'ecografo.
120, dottoressa.
Perfetto.
Ok, ancora.
180.
Ok. Beh, siamo.
Mi passeresti anche uno zaffo poi da lasciare in
sì.
vagina?
Sì,
subito.
Cosa diamo? Top.
Zaffo.
Perfetto.
Okay. Dottore, metto il catetere?
Certo.
Okay. Come va?
Catetere messo.
Quanto sono le perdite?
Ok, la pressione.
I parametri.
Morto.
Sono arrivate le due sacche.
Abbiamo la
4 minuti da
L'utero è contratto, Fabri?
Sì, allora. Che sotto
ok, c'è anche il... Ok, perfetto. Dal pallone non perde più.
Sì, nulla.
Facciamo un altro gas. Vediamo a che punto siamo con l'emoglobina dopo la prima sacca.
Signora,
siamo sulla seconda.
Beh, ma si sveglierà tra poco.
Sì, abbiamo sospeso la sedazione.
Va,
adesso
si sta svegliando.
Ho 8 di emoglobina.
Bene.
Salva.
Stop. Scenario.
How do you think about the video?
Very nice. Thank you very much. Really, really nice.
I think a big mess. because the first problem was in that day, I asked to Pier Paolo, please.
In your opinion, what are the pros and cons of this video?
The problems
of this video, in your opinion. For example, I think that team leader wasn't clear.
Yes, I wanted to say that because I asked Super Paolo to do the leader. But then when I was there, I can't avoid to do myself.
Because you are a consultant, normal. He's a resident, normal. In real life, so.
Yes.
Other good things about the video. Did you perform all right passage of postpartum hemorrhage?
Yes, I think we did. Probably we had to use the balloon early, because I don't remember.
No, avevamo cambiato.
And do you have do you use acid, tranexamic acid in your reality?
If we use?
Yes.
We have actually we have bought it, but we don't have much experience with it. Our anesthesiologists, they do give it. We don't really, I mean, for me, I don't really understand how it works and how it should be given. And then if I'm a little afraid about what I don't know in terms of the risk of, you know, there are some myths related to the risk of thrombosis with it. It would be very helpful if you could comment on that for us.
Very useful drug, because there was a trial, named was Woman Trial, about the use of acid tranexamic in pregnant to women after partum entry. And the use morbidity and mortality for postpartum. So we do it in first line, like a drug, and our Italian guidelines recommended in acid tranexamic for first drug, like oxytocin or other. So we use the always when we have a big hemorrhage, more than 500 in natural and cesarean section.
How do you give it? Orally, intravenously?
Intravenously.
And
1 gram in 2-3 minutes, and we can repeat it after 30 minutes.
And with them,
we haven't a lot of disadvantage, because luckily pregnant woman is same patient, so you haven't a progressive infarct or other problem like ictus or ischemic attack, so you can use it.
So what's the maximum dose?
The maximum dose was 3 grams in 12 hours, I remember, but I have to see it.
Okay.
Normally, 1 gram is enough.
Okay, thank you very much.
Other good things in this video? The early use of balloon. Do you use it a lot or not?
We use it. We are happy to have it and we use it. We use it a lot. Sometimes we have failures. Do you check by ultrasound if it is placed correctly? Sometimes it can slip from the uterus and go in the vagina.
We put it in echographic vision and stay for 24 hours.
We put 180 cc of water in the balloon. Do you think is it correct or not?
I think it should be a little bit more, no?
No, I think
less.
If you check the back of the balloon, and if you check the technical paper, they advise 300 till 500. So probably 180 is few.
It's a mechanical good solution, because if you use too lot drugs like prostaglandins, you can have a pulmonary edema. We had a case after a lot of prostaglandins during the night, and the next day the pregnant woman had 92% of saturation and 4 centimeters of pleuric effusion.
So, I didn't know that.
We didn't know.
We had a case of pulmonary edema from beta mimetics that we use for tocolysis. But we, with prostaglandin, we don't, our national guidelines, so we don't have on the market misoprostol. We don't have where to buy.
No. Now we have carbuprost for 1 month. Before we had Suprostone. Before we had Suprostone, and now we have carbuprost. But we have a drug range. Sometimes you have pregnant woman more like a preeclamptic woman. So she developed an pulmonary edema, and with prostaglandins you have a huge edema.
And now we talk about the anesthesiology point of view. And I remember you that maternal mortality, the classification of maternal mortality, indirect, that death resulting from obstetric complication in pregnancy and labor, and the puerperium like 42 days. Indirect, that resulting from previous existing disease, so not relating to obstetric complication, and developing during pregnancy or aggravating during pregnancy. For example, some cardiovascular disease. And late, from 42 days after birth to the first year postpartum. In our country, the first case of maternal mortality is obstetric hemorrhage. But in the last year, we have sepsis that become the second causes of maternal mortality. And it's the same in the other country. In fact, now there is a lot of interest about sepsis in parents. What about the classification of urgency for you, but for us too, because it's a guideline from obstetrician, Royal College of Obstetrician, but Royal College of Anesthetists too. We have some different colors, red, orange, yellow and green one, and all number of category from 1 to 4. For the category 1 or red code, we have immediate threat to life of woman or fetus. But what about the time to have a birth in this case of red C-section? The name of the interval from the decision to perform the cesarean section to the birth is called a decision to delivery interval. And for red C-section is 30 minutes, but in some cases better 15. In yellow C-section we have 75 minutes, and in green we are a programmable C-section. What about 3 minutes rule? It's very important for us and for neonatologists. In condition of no blood flow, like abrupt placenta or prolapse cord without beating of the cord, every minute we have the pH of the fetus decreases of 0.01. And in case of bradycardia below 80 beats per minute, in 20 minutes is associated with neurologic sequelae for the newborn. So it's very important to have a good communication and perform a lot of simulation to increase and have an increase of this DDI, so this time. This is a really call or everyday call in our life. Hello, there is an urgent cesarean section. And this is my face when this call arrived, because there aren't information, the color of C-section, the indication of C-section, no. In this case, it can be red or yellow or green, I don't know. And I don't know why we perform a C-section. So it's important, a good communication to timely delivery of the fetus, because if I know the code, the color code of the C-section and indication, I can think about my anesthesia. Spinal anesthesia, general anesthesia, or I have an epidural catheter, I can use it for the anesthesia. And other important things is the time taken for a patient to reach the operating theater, because the most wasting time is to prepare the pregnant woman and to take her to the operating theater. We can reduce potential maternal risk. In fact, it's important to avoid general anesthesia. So, what about local and general anesthesia? It's our amniotic duct, like to be or not to be, is for us local, regional, and general anesthesia. What we think about the anesthesia when you call us and say, okay, there is a cesarean section, we think a lot of problems and factors affecting our choice. So this woman is has a comorbidities like obesity, or what is his fasting status, or it's present in epidural catheter or not. Another important thing is the timing of cesarean section and the experience of the anesthetist, because we perform a lot of delivery and a lot of cesarean section, and we are a dedicated group of anesthetists. We attend all only the delivery room, so we have a lot of experience about spinal anesthesia. So we perform spinal anesthesia more or less in 1-2 minutes. Another important thing for us is fasting status, because I always say that only your grandmother and your anesthetist is interested about your fasting status, because we have a lot of change of mind about the anesthesia if you are fasting or not. And another big problem, especially nowadays, is obesity, because we have a lot of pregnant women with a very high weight, 100, 130. So it's very, very difficult. It's very, very dangerous to perform a general anesthesia in this case. Okay. So if your patient has an epidural catheter, she's candidate for an emergency urgency cesarean section, you have to call the anesthetist immediately, because he can use that catheter to perform the anesthesia for cesarean section. Normally, we inject a local anesthetic inside the epidural catheter. In more or less 10 minutes, we have a good anesthesia for the cesarean section. And it's important to inject the local anesthesia not in the delivery room, not in operating room, but in the delivery room. So we have a little bit of time to have a good anesthesia until we arrive in the operation room. So it's important to call the anesthesist immediately, so he can inject the local anesthesia in the delivery room. In this public lecture was the conversation from labral epidural analgesia to anesthesia. They recommended for an onset in 2 minutes, so very, very good time, lidocaine 2%, 18 milliliters, and bicarbonate and epinephrine. If you have more time, for example, for dysthocia or for a cesarean section more than 20 minutes, with a DDI more than 20 minutes, you can use ropivacaine, the 0.75% from 10 to 15 milliliters. So you can have a more good anesthesia with ropivacaine alone than the lidocaine. You have to choose lidocaine for fast and ropivacaine for quality. So what about the obstetric guidelines of anesthesia from the American guidelines? It's important selecting neuraxial technique in preference of general anesthesia for most cesarean derived. And for urgency, it's important to use the epidural catheter. In this report from Royal College of Anesthetists, you see that they proposed the standard for best practice, and they propose more 50% of cesarean section category one with regional anesthesia and not with general anesthesia. So more than 50% of category one cesarean section should be performed in regional anesthesia. And remember that many emergencies don't occur entirely de novo, and some anesthetic planning can take place in advance of the obstetric decision for emergency cesarean section. And then when planning is not possible, it's important that the anesthetist be quickly familiarized with silent point in patient history, for example, obesity, fasting status, or the thrombocytopenia, and perform the rapid airway assessment. Because now we are going to talk about this, pregnant women have a difficult airway. And it's important that your anesthetist have a high level of confidence. So you can perform a spinal anesthesia instead of general anesthesia if you perform a lot of spinal anesthesia normally. Why we don't like general anesthesia? We don't like general anesthesia because intubation of an obstetric woman is more difficult than the other patient. We have an incident of failed tracheal intubation and maternal mortality. In fact, when you see the report about maternal mortality, the anesthesia-related maternal mortality is for failed tracheal intubation in a lot of cases. Another problem is general anesthesia, because when you give some drugs intravenously, all the drugs pass to the baby. So it's better to choose a spinal anesthesia or epidural anesthesia, neuraxial anesthesia. And why it's more difficult to intubate a pregnant woman? Because she has an increased breast size, so there is a difficult insertion of a laryngoscope, and you can have a decreasing more quick that oxygen. You have an increase of risk of airway bleeding and increase of oxygen desaturation because the baby put outside the lungs. And then we have a decrease of lower esophageal sphincter tone. So there are higher risk to have a regurgitation, gastric regurgitation, and pulmonary aspiration. This is a very interesting report about Balanapati Plus that changed during pregnancy, labor, and after delivery. I put here the Balanapati Plus, plus one, two, three, and four. You see in this report, during time two, a time three, you have the, a worsening Balanapati Plus. When is time two? Time two is during labor, and time three is 20 minutes after delivery. So when you can have a urgent emergency cesarean section, and when you can have a postpartum hemorrhage. So during labor and 20 minutes after delivery, you have a very, very high risk of failed intubation and Balanapati Plus worsening. This is the algorithm for the obstetric general anesthesia and failed tracheal intubation from difficulty airway society. You can see that they divide in three flowcharts: green one, orange one, and red one. Green one, you can use the like one attempt or two attempt of intubation. Orange one, you can use a supraglottic airway device because here you are in emergency situation, and the red one is the worst case you can have always, that it can't intubate, it can't oxygenate. Because for us, not a real problem can't intubate. The real problem is can't oxygenate. So we can give oxygen to our patient, pregnant or not. And so in that case, we have to do front over neck access. Why? In other cases, we can decide to wake up the patient. In this case, we can't, because we can wait for the cesarean section. We have to do it in a really, really short time. This is adult cardiac arrest algorithm from American Heart Association. And for pregnant women is the same, little bit some different that now we see. What change in pregnant women for the cardiac arrest algorithm? You have some modification related to physiology of pregnancy. And you have a displace of mediastinum upward in the chest. And so you have a compression of aorta cava from 20 gestational week to the term. And other physiological changes, increase of cardiac output and increase of blood volume. For ventilation, we have another other modification, the decrease of functional residual capacity and increase in requirement of oxygen and decrease of chest compliance due to abdominal pressure. So chest compression are more difficult. So here we have the site of the uterus, and you see that after 20 weeks, we are more interested of vena cava. So if you have a pregnant woman in cardiac arrest more than 20 weeks, you have to perform a left uterine displacement or one-handed or two-handed technique. But now it's not permitted now the position patient in the 30 degree, because in this case, chest compression are not a good quality of chest compression. So it's better to prefer this position with ended uterine displacement than with 30 degrees. Unfortunately, if your pregnant woman is in cardiac arrest, you have to perform a perimortem cesarean section after 4 minutes. You have to continue the chest compression for 4 minutes, but you have to perform a cesarean section within 5 minutes with the xiphopubical incision. It's preferred. And in this case, you have a return of placental blood, a release of inferior vena cava, you have an improving in ventilation, so you can have a possibility to save a newborn, but the mother too. And this is the same flowchart from ACLS, but with this cartoon inside that explain what I've said now. What about preeclampsia, eclampsia for anesthetist? So we know that there are some risk factor, high risk factor and moderate risk factor. And I want to add another risk factor that is very modern risk factor, like Arianna knows, that it's medically assisted procreation. What is our interest about preeclampsia? The edema. The edema, pulmonary edema, and obviously cerebral edema. In the four drugs, we use the intravenous labetalolo, hidralazina, we haven't hidralazina here, but we use a lot of labetalolo for control of the blood pressure. Please, if you perform a continuous infusion, remember to monitor the diuresis, oral liquid intake, and every 6 hours, blood Dexam. Because in preeclampsia, you can have an ELF syndrome, and so you can have a low platelet count, very quick low platelet count, and a worsening in renal and hepatic function. For eclampsia, I love magnesium sulfate. This is about MAGP trial. Remember that the tonic-clonic seizure caused of inappropriately treated of preeclampsia or a misunderstood preeclampsia. We have a high risk of mortality and morbidity for the cardiac arrest and cerebral hemorrhage. What about the therapy of magnesium sulfate? The leading dose is 4-5 grams in 5 minutes. An infusion is 1 gram for hour for 24 hours. If you have any other seizure, you have to give other 2 grams in bolus of magnesium sulfate. You can have control of the magnesium concentration in blood without the blood exam and only with the clinic. You can see that if you have a HCG change, you can have a 2.5 or 5 millimoliliter magnesium sulfate concentration. So you can use this advice to control the magnesium concentration instead of request a blood exam. And remember that if you have an intoxication of magnesium sulfate, the antidote is calcium gluconato 10%, 10 milliliters every 10 minutes. What about HELLP syndrome for us? For us, the very problem is thrombocytopenia, because if you have a very, very low platelet count below 50, we have to perform a general anesthesia, and we don't like general anesthesia in pregnant women. And in case of HELLP, please consider a magnesium therapy to prevent the eclampsia seizure. So it's very important to communicate the status of a pregnant woman in case of preeclampsia and HELLP syndrome. We had an HELLP syndrome 2 days ago with the platelet count of 55, and we performed general anesthesia because she administered the Clexane twice a day. So we hadn't a choice. In this case, for preeclampsia, what about the analgesia? Because I remember that we are for the emergency, but we are for the pain control too during labor. And I hope that you perform a lot of pain control in labor in your hospital. So we put an Arsia catheter, an early insertion before labor or in the beginning of labor for preeclampsia, because you can have a good blood pressure control if the pregnant woman doesn't feel pain. So it's very important to control pain in preeclampsia, because you have a lot of production of catecholamines. For cesarean section, we perform a local regional anesthesia if platelet count is okay, but we have to remember that we can have an important hypotension caused of a sympathetic block. We treat it with ephedrina. Phenylephrine is better choice, but we haven't in Italy. Oxytocin, please give it very, very slowly, because it can produce a more important hypotension until a cardiac arrest. So if you have a lot of hemorrhage during cesarean section and you give oxytocin very, very quick, you can have a cardiac arrest. Metilergometrina can start a myocardial infarction, so it's better avoid it in preeclampsia. What about the problems for general anesthesia in preeclamptic women? The saturation is more rapid than in the other pregnant woman. So if you think that pregnant woman is more desaturated than other patients, preeclamptic women are more than desaturation than pregnant women. There is an important airway edema, so the intubation is most difficult. And my advice is to use a neurotracheal tube half visure less than normal. During induction, please, during preeclampsia and eclampsia, you have to administer opioids and beta blockers, because you can have and a cerebral hemorrhage if you have a very, very high blood pressure during laryngoscopy. So it's very, very important to administer opioids. This is our first case, a pregnant woman of 38 years old, BMI 32, hospitalized for hypertension in pregnancy, 28 and 3 days gestational age, with blood pressure 170-110, and urine protein sticks 4+. She had a very, very interesting medical history because she had an accidental ingestion of antidepressant drugs when she was 2 years old. And the anesthetist performed a lot of attempts of oral tracheal intubation. She had a lot of surgical tracheostomy in her life. So she had a very, very big scar of the neck for the tracheostomy, and last control of the skull was 10 years ago. She had no therapy. So she was hospitalized in maternity ward and started therapy for preeclampsia. And they gave betamethasone for fetal lung maturity. And we started the non-invasive blood pressure monitoring. She performed a renal echography too, a pulmonary echography, and we had 2.5 centimeters of edema in right lung, so she started to have an edema. We performed an otolaryngologist examination. We have a problem to say it in Italian too, otolaryngologist. And the blast gas analysis. And like you see that PO2 was very, very low. 56, but probably she always lived with a very, very low oxygen saturation in blood. But she refused oxygen therapy during hospitalization. We performed blood exam. You see that Astendalt was higher. And then we performed a fibrolaryngoscopy with the conclusion of tracheal stenosis of 4.5 millimeters, so very, very little lumen. In fact, the otolaryngologist recommended protective tracheostomy before cesarean section. We had a counseling with the woman. She initially, on 27 of April, she refused the tracheostomy. The day after, she accepted the surgical tracheostomy. It was more or less 3-4 p.m. when she accepted the surgical tracheostomy, and it was planned on 29 of April. But we had a very, very big bomb. On 28 of April at 7:45 p.m., her sister in law called the nurses for collapse in the bathroom, and she had a cardiac arrest for respiratory arrest. Probably her pulmonary effusion or other. We immediately started the CPR, chest compression, and performed the emergency cesarean section, and the baby born at 7:57. PM with a good Apgar 368, and I see you that the baby is okay now. But this isn't an happy ending story. We tried to perform an emergent tracheostomy, but we did it because of a very, very huge scar. We couldn't perform a percutaneous tracheostomy. The otolaryngologist arrived after too many minutes and performed a surgical tracheostomy. We continued the CPR until an organized rhythm, but she never woken up. And it was 4 years ago. This is a second case about another pregnant woman of 33 years old, hospitalized for hypertension in pregnancy, 23 gestational age with frontal headache unresponsive to treatment, with nausea and vomiting. No medical history and no therapy. She went to another emergency department of another hospital for a headache. They performed a cerebral magnetic resonance, but it was negative, so they discharged the patient to home. After 1 week, more or less, she returned to our emergency department with headache, nausea, and vomiting, and she appeared drowsy but collaborating. So we decided to perform another cerebral MRI, and this was the result. You see, Otto, blood inside the ventricles here and here. The same night, it was 2 a.m. Between the night, we placed an EVD under local anesthesia, and then the day after, she performed an intravascular embolization of a little, very, very little arteriovenous malformation. And this procedure required general anesthesia, and intravascular embolization was okay. As you see here, no, here, all the blood. After this, we had a multidisciplinary discussion for planning the delivery, and we decided to proceed with the cesarean section at 38 gestational age, so 3 months, and under general anesthesia, obviously, because she had acute hemorrhage, cerebral hemorrhage. So in this case, we can't perform a spinal anesthesia. 74 days after, we performed the delivery in general anesthesia, and a male infant was born with a good Apgar 7, 9, 10, and weight of 3,048 grams. The infant was transferred to the newborn nursery, and he was okay. And currently, the lady performs brain monitoring every 2 years. But this is an happy ending story. So 2 years ago, she successfully completed the Padova marathons. And nowadays, her child is 4 years old and is fine. Last year, she delivered her second baby. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you. Some questions about
very difficult cases.
I don't listen.
Very difficult cases. I don't know what EDV means for the last case.
Yeah, the drainage of for intracranial pressure.
Yeah,
because she had a very, very high intracranial pressure. So the DVE is the drainage of intracranial pressure.
And she had a brain surgery while she was pregnant, isn't it?
Yes, the same night we had DVE, and the day after, she performed the embolism with a lot of radiation, and radiation haven't any problem with her pregnancy. So you can perform if it's necessary. For example, we performed X-ray, chest X-ray, because if it's important.
Yes. Yes, with a shield in the abdomen. But you can do, yeah, we can do it. And many doctors are afraid, but it's good to have to send this message.
Because it's important to change mind. Probably in the first trimester is important, but a lot of time, first trimester, she doesn't know that she's pregnant, so don't know.
And my second question is, if you use in women with preeclampsia as analgesics after delivery, non-inflammatory and non-steroidal anti-inflammatories, or what do you use for pain relief after delivery?
We use
pain delivery for preeclampsia.
We have two choice. The first one is a top block, that is traversal abdominal pain trap block. We perform two puncture and inject the local anesthesia in after the C-section. Or we use a intravenous, continuous intravenous with opioids and fans too. It depends on blood loss during cesarean section. If we have a lot of blood losses, we don't use it. If we have a normal blood losses, we use it without problem. And now we start to perform a combination anesthesia, spinal more epidural catheter. So you can use the epidural catheter after cesarean section. For example, when we have a epidural catheter for analgesia, and then the lady have a cesarean section, we use epidural catheter for the anesthesia and for postoperative pain.
Without
continual infusion in the catheter, because she can have a lot of paresthesia. So we put a PCA, it's a passive controlled analgesia.
Thank you. We have seen many cases, and we still don't realize it yet, but I have seen many cases with, we have a lot of preeclampsias because we get them from around. And if they bleed a lot, and then if they get another non-steroidal anti-inflammatory by mouth several days after, they can get renal damage. They can get renal, even, I don't know.
You can use a different technique in these cases. You can use transversal abdominal block and oral opioid, because you can give opioids during puerperium. It's not really fast in breastfeeding until the patient is very, very soporoso, sleeping. So,
I have never seen
opioid, it's okay for breastfeeding.
I have never seen the transverse abdominal block. Maybe we should discuss it with our anesthetist. And also, what we don't have these PCAs, the patient controlled administration of analgesic. And maybe I've seen it in London, I've seen it in other places, but we don't have it yet. However, we use the spinal, the epidural catheter. We use that.
Yes, we put always for analgesia during labor, because it's very, very important for blood pressure control too, and for the level of catecholamines. So when you have pain, you have a lot of catecholamines, and during preeclampsia is the worst thing you can have. So it's very, very important control the pain during labor. And during the cesarean section, spinal anesthesia is preferred for problem with difficult airways. And if you have a good blood flow count, you can do it. So we use the 50 blood flow count, like a range for spinal anesthesia. For epidural anesthesia, we use more or less 100 or platelet count, and we see the trend. It's a lower trend or higher trend.
Thank you very much.
Now we will see some videos.
Permesso. Signora, salve, siamo le ostetriche. Signora. L'ostetrica Cara. Del cambio. Signora?
Cara, come adesso va?
Signora?
Signora?
Dottoressa non risponde.
Signora. Non respira?
No. Chiamo il mio strutturato intanto.
Sì,
ok.
Chiamiamo subito aiuto.
Dottore, codice rosso, c'è un arresto in paziente gravida.
Ti arrivo subito.
Allora, dobbiamo iniziare.
Si libera, subito. Dimmi che cosa succede.
Dottore, guardi, non c'è polso.
Dobbiamo
okay?
iniziare subito il massaggio.
Perfetto, io okay. monitorizzo
vai,
la paziente.
Vai, iniziati, lateralizzo l'utero.
Sì, anche,
prendi anche
colleghi,
degli accessi venosi.
Subito. Anestesista di guardia, codice rosso, arresto in gravida.
Allora, l'accesso venoso
al cambio, cazzo.
Ok.
Accesso venoso. Ma
che succede? Abbiamo i parametri.
La signora non è responsiva.
Quindi, allora, Giorgia, per favore, continua a massaggiare. Francesco, mettiti alle VR.
Dimmi quando vuoi il cambio.
Avete controllato il ritmo, ragazzi?
Non ancora, dobbiamo monitorare.
Libera, esatto, okay. Prenderesti le piastre.
Quant'è che state massaggiando?
Ho iniziato meno di un minuto fa.
Ok, per favore vai avanti, un pochettino più veloce, Giorgia, esatto, per favore.
Piastre.
Francesco, okay. È un ambu, ragazzi, appena le piastre ci sono, interrompiamo il massaggio e controlliamo il ritmo, per favore.
Ok, tanto ventila.
Piastre messe.
Ok, Giorgia, per favore, lì. Spostati, guardiamo il ritmo. Francesco, un attimo.
Sì, vai, tranquillo.
Ok, abbiamo un ritmo organizzato, sì. Controlliamo il polso, per favore. Polso assente.
Non c'è.
Ok, polso assente, vai avanti a massaggiare, per favore. Ok, esatto, Pier, tu mantieni la dislocazione dell'utero. Per favore, libera, mi aspireresti un milligrammo di adrenalina?
Subito.
Ok. Grazie a chi ha seguito la paziente, mi faccia pensare per somministrarla direttamente in volo.
Perfetto.
Così di che lava la via con 20 ml di fisiologica.
Dovrebbe essere
okay, adrenalina somministrata.
Molto bene.
Vuoi il cambio?
Allora, sì, forse è meglio che dai il cambio. Spostati e lateralizza l'utero. Vai pure.
Vai.
Ok, abbiamo somministrato un milligrammo di adrenalina, okay. Abbiamo una PEA. Ragazzi, cosa può essere? Io controllo un attimo i tempi. Cosa potrebbe essere stato secondo voi?
La signora ha fatto un bolo in peridurale.
Ok, è verosimile che possa essere andato in vena?
Io ho appena
30.
Ho appena montato, non saprei. Se...
Ok, nel dubbio magari gli facciamo comunque dentro di più, cosa dici Francesco?
Ok, io mi
libero per favore, se hai modo, aspira, prepara dell'intralipid, li facciamo.
Perfetto.
200 ml infusione in 3-4 minuti.
Due minuti dopo... dall'inizio dell'attacco.
Esattamente.
Preparato.
Tu dici quando siamo a 4, quando stiamo per arrivare 30. A 4 minuti, per
sì,
favore.
Sì, messo farmaco richiesto.
Ok, sì. Perfetto. Lascio l'infusione in modo che scenda in 2-3 minuti.
Perfetto.
Okay. Io mi preparo per una via aerea intanto.
Grazie Francesco. Se vuoi, valuta tu se vuoi intubare o provare o mettere direttamente una IGEL.
21. Ora
vado di IGEL.
Ok,
25, vai, 6, 7, 8, 9, 30.
Allora, benissimo. No, vai, continua pure il massaggio, andiamo okay. in asincrono.
Ragazzi, siamo quasi a 2 minuti, fai gli ultimi 30, dopodiché guardiamo il ritmo.
Libera, quanti minuti sono dall'attacco?
Quasi 3.
Un po' più veloce, Pier, forse? Un po' meno veloce.
Staying okay. alive.
Come profondità ci siamo, valuta,
che preparo il tavolo?
Valuta bene di mollare, adesso direi che facciamo un controllo del ritmo.
Aspettiamo il controllo del ritmo.
Ok, okay. Pier, staccati, per favore controlliamo. Abbiamo sempre un ritmo organizzato, un po' bradicardico, andiamo comunque a controllare il polso. Polso presente, polso assente?
Polso presente, polso... io non lo sento.
Sì. C'è il polso?
Sì.
Okay.
Polso,
ok, abbiamo un ROSC, ragazzi, misuriamo una pressione, okay. Vediamo la saturazione okay. della paziente, lei risponde.
Prepara comunque la sala, non serve che lo facciamo emergente.
Perfetto, tienti 4 minuti.
Pronto. Perfetto.
Perfetto.
Ok, this video are not ideally. So we can talk about this video. So we have our best actress here and our best actor, Giulio, online. Giulio, turn on the microphone and webcam.
Do you have some question for our actor?
Congratulations. You did very well. You acted very well. It was very realistic.
How do you feel during this scenario?
Well, the main problem maybe is that when you are there, you almost forget what you know in the first time. So in the first place, you are there and really feel that like it's an emergency. So it's quite realistic, and it is actually a good thing because you feel in the like you are in real life. And sometimes, even if you know what you are supposed to do, you just act like it was normal to do. So it's you don't have so much time to think. Even if it's a simulation, it's quite realistic, I think. And I remember that I didn't even count how many chest compressions I did, even if I know how many I should do. But in that moment, I was just doing chest compressions.
And you had a very, very good rhythm.
Very
like
good rhythm.
The song.
So.
And what about you, Giulio? You was a very, very good team leader. Microfono. Non ci sentiamo.
What about now? Yeah, okay. I think I was quite acceptable as a team leader, so I had a good team too. Because, of course, we had a good communication between us. We used a closed loop communication. So that was good, but sometimes other team members tried to remember to me things to do. Like one time, Francesco, the other actor, the other anesthesiologist, told me, "Can I put an advanced airway?" So he remembered me. It was time to control airways. So it was a good simulation because also in reality, I think it's like that. So we have a team leader that must control like a orchestra director, but sometimes other teammates must do their part and help the team leader too. They're not like robots that do as they told, but they have a mind too. So I like that about our simulation.
And my opinion, the best moment was your thinking moment. What is happening? So what's happening first? Local anesthesia, yeah. Epidural catheter. Probably the epidural catheter was in vain.
Yeah.
So you had an intoxication of local anesthetic. And you gave a right drug in that case.
So, yeah.
My opinion, it was the best thing.
Yeah, it was a moment when we had the situation more or less under control. So knowing that we had a PEA, so a pulse electrical activity, we took some time to think about the possible causes of the cardiac arrest. So, yeah.
Any question for our actors?
Do you take your team regularly in training, in day-to-day life? Do you do this once or twice a year? I don't know. Do you do this?
We hope to start a regular simulation. We perform it random. But I hope that in this year we have one every 2-3 months. To have AI perform during our real life. Mm-hmm. Now we'll see another video about preeclampsia.
Permesso.
Sì, ci avevano avvisato.
Dica.
Cos'è successo?
Tanto sono gli occhi aperti
Salve signora!
Come si chiama, signora?
Allora,
signora,
un attimino,
come si chiama?
Calmi.
Germana.
Signora Germana?
Okay.
Germana?
Germana?
Mi sente?
Salve.
Ha mal di testa?
Okay.
Sì, certo, se no non sarebbe
okay,
qui,
allora,
immagino.
Allora, dottore, guardi, ha detto che ha mal di testa. Le metto il bracciale della pressione.
Prendiamo i parametri.
Ok?
E prendiamo
guardi,
anche un accesso venoso.
Tranquillo, adesso vediamo. Monitorizzo. No, assolutamente, guardi. Adesso
la gravidanza com'è andata fino adesso?
Parametri messi.
Non ha mai avuto problemi, non ha mai preso farmaci durante la gravidanza?
Che senta, tipo di farmaci ha preso? Mal di pancia? Germana, mi sente? Okay. Adesso proviamo a sentire il battito, ok? Che
Germana, riesce a stringermi la mano, Germana?
Dottore, io
riesce a stringermi la mano? Germana?
Ecografo messo.
Okay. Oddio.
Niente, allora guardi.
Libera, dottore, prendi un accesso venoso, si allontani un attimo.
Già preso.
Si allontani
subito.
Un attimo, per favore.
Si allontani un attimino, stia tranquillo. Allora,
Germana,
dottore,
Libera, prendi un accesso venoso.
Accesso venoso preso, la giriamo.
Chiamo l'anestesista.
Fianco.
Anestesista, abbiamo una crisi eclamptica in corso.
Esatto, accidenti. Girato sul fianco.
Allora,
paziente girata sul fianco.
Bene.
Eccola.
Mettiamo su un po' di midazolam. Ma...
Subitissimo ve lo preparo.
Sì, te lo
prepariamo
preparo.
Anche il magnesio solfato.
Grazie.
18:30.
Magnesio solfato. Un po' di ossigenetto anche. Potrebbe essere una cosa
sì.
buona e giusta.
Allora,
sì.
midazolam.
Questo mi arrangio io.
Sì, grazie.
Okay.
Abbiamo un accesso venoso funzionante. Sì.
Dottore, volete che metta una Gedel?
Francesco, faccio già il midazolam, sai.
Non so se riesci, che se si è morso, se aspetta un secondo, casomai che
no,
passi.
No, sono riuscita.
Benissimo.
Perfetto.
Francesco, ho fatto il midazolam, poi appena la libera mi passa io faccio anche il magnesio.
Ok,
sai?
Partiamo con 2 grammi di magnesio. La pressione
subito.
Com'era?
La pressione 217,
era... 117-109.
Libera, aspiralo pure puro il magnesio, sai.
Ok.
La betalolo?
Sì, procediamo anche con la betalolo.
Ok.
Perfetto.
Aspettiamo che passi.
Dottore, magnesio solfato pronto?
Ok.
E io farei 4 grammi invece
4
che 2. Sì.
Io farei 4 anch'io.
La betalolo?
40.
40 lo preparo subito.
Il magnesio l'abbiamo messo in infusione
fine, a
sì.
canna, okay.
A canna, okay. 4 grammi. E la betalolo lo somministro 40 grammi, 40 mg.
Trandate pronto.
Sì.
Sì.
Passano, cioè, fallo pure se hai voglia tu.
Perfetto. Abbiamo una saturazione, la crisi sembra essere passata.
Saturimetro
la saturazione
messo,
è a 96.
Il respiro com'è? Ok.
Misuriamo okay. un'altra pressione.
Ok. Un'altra pressione. Ok.
Germana.
E riusciamo a sentire il battito? Perfetto. Dottore, l'utero è rilassato?
Sì, sì, ho sentito.
Ok, okay, state saturando un pochino.
La pressione è sempre quella?
Vedi una mano a respirare. Mi passi la maschera, per favore.
Subito.
Filtro, grazie.
Francesco, la pressione è sempre altina.
Hai gel pronta? Okay.
Prendiamo anche un altro accesso.
Senz'altro. Secondo te è da fare un cesareo o Piero?
No, per ora stabilizziamo la paziente, poi vediamo se si rende necessario il cesareo.
Francesco, la pressione è ancora altina, dici che è da fare altro trandate?
Sì, cosmai la mettiamo anche in infusione continua.
Certo.
Dottore, sta avendo un'altra crisi, ragazzi.
Non sa che ripetiamo
midazolam.
Ripetiamo midazolam
e aumenterei anche il
trandate. Magnesio. Anche il magnesio da ripetere. Libero.
Aumenterei il trandate a 80.
Altri
4.
Sì.
Una alla volta, ragazzi. Ok.
Okay. Il trandate quanto ne preparo?
Prepara pure altri 4 grammi, adesso 4 vediamo.
Grammi di magnesio
e 80
di
trandate.
Grazie.
Poi direi che il trandate possiamo
okay,
anche iniziare
magnesio.
In infusione.
Lo metto su.
Okay.
Sì. Apri tutto.
Messo.
Come va il battito?
10 mg
ok,
di
ditemi voi quando volete su anche il trandate.
Sì, sì, il trandate lo facciamo in infusione.
Subito.
Quanto, quanto bradicardico?
Trandate messo. Ok, giriamola meglio sul fianco. Ok, dottore vuole che mi vada a lavare intanto? Prepariamo il tavolo.
La paziente è stabile.
Quanto abbiamo di pressione adesso?
Siamo sempre altini.
Sempre quella?
4 minuti dall'ultima dalla prima crisi.
Iniziamo l'infusione continua di trendata, direi.
Giusto, giusto, okay. L'infusione continua di trendata. Siamo a quanto? Okay. 2 dosi di magnesio.
2 dosi di magnesio, dobbiamo anche iniziare l'infusione continua di magnesio.
E cominciamo anche l'infusione continua di magnesio.
Prepara una pompa siringa.
Preparo, ok. Quanti? L'infusione continua?
Un grammo ora, vuol dire.
All'ora?
Sì, esatto.
Ok.
10 ml ora, puoi mettere, se lo spiri puro.
Va bene.
Va bene.
10 ml ora,
se
okay.
La paziente è stabile, possiamo procedere con il cesareo, sì.
Ok. Ci proviamo con l'anestesia generale.
Ok, perfetto.
Con opioidi o
senza opioidi? Con opioidi, assolutamente. Quindi...
Ok. What about this video now? What do you think about this one? These are our best residents. Mm-hmm. And... they worked very, very well.
No, they were less experienced than the previous actors, but they tried their best because I was looking that they were giving everything and the blood pressure was not dropping.
Yes, they all. And what about you, Giulio, in this scenario?
Yeah, one moment, I almost gave 4 grams of labetalol to the patients because of that communication.
Mother that.
Yeah, but again, the team was good.
Very, very interesting, because you did a big mistake for a dosage, and the other member team said, you know, it's not okay, but it's 4 grams of magnesium and milligrams of labetalol. It's a pro, no?
Yeah, the good communication with the team and the fact we are, I had a correction by a teammate.
In this case, there isn't a team leader.
I think, it's not well defined, maybe Francesco at the beginning, but then we were both a nun.
What about the drugs of for eclampsia? Have you did all correct in your opinion?
What?
Have you did all correct in your opinion?
Yeah, we gave magnesium. First bolus, then she had another seizure, so we gave again magnesium and started the infusion. So about magnesium, we did correct with the right. So 4 grams, then again another.
The bolus after the second eclampsia. Yeah. And a very important take-home message is to stabilize before the passing and then perform cesarean section. Because it's not safe for the mother perform a cesarean section during an eclamptic seizure, because eclamptic is a medical emergency, not a surgical emergency. So it's very, very important to stabilize before the passing, before to perform the cesarean section.
Yeah.
Are you okay?
Mm-hmm. Can I ask something?
Yes.
By protocol, you turn them on your on the left side when they have eclamptic seizures. We don't do, and I was wondering maybe it's something that we haven't.
They did it automatically because during a seizure you have a left thinking of the passing, but in eclamptic seizure you cannot do it. So because during another type of seizure you have to put the patient on left side for the gastric regurgitation and pulmonary aspiration. So this because she was non-conscious. And you know that after a eclamptic seizure, you have to, you can have a post-critical status.
So with a pregnant woman that breathes, but she doesn't respond. So it's important to focalize in that moment. In that moment, she hasn't a neurological status alert, because she is in post-critical status, like other things. What do you do in your hospital?
We leave them to try to, you know, to make the place safe, not for them to hit the head or things like that. We try to move them at least in one side. We do magnesium sulfate, exactly the same protocol that you showed. For the blood pressure, unfortunately, we do not have labetalol in our country. We don't have hydralazine either. So if you can imagine, we are left with no many choices. Our anesthetists found a good solution. We give them Ebrantil.
Or probably it's better nifedipine in this case.
We don't have IV nifedipine either. So nifedipine we have oral, labetalol we don't have oral, hydralazine we don't have. So the only solution for IV control of high blood pressure in pregnancy that our anesthetists found was this Ebrantil, which is a, I think it's an alpha 2 agonist that acts centrally, I think.
And the name of
Urapidil, exactly, yeah, Urapidil. And we use that for controlling high blood pressure when we need to do that.
What about the anesthesia for cesarean section? On the general anesthesia?
We have, so what I've seen in the last, let's say 10 years, it was a gradual move from general anesthesia to spinal anesthesia. And now the young anesthetists, they always prefer spinal anesthesia for emergencies, you know, they can do it very fast. And they feel, I don't know, it feels better to have the mother, I mean, yeah. So we do a lot of spinals as well.
Very, very dangerous for the mother, have a general anesthesia. And in this case, it's very, very important if you have to do a general anesthesia to give opioids drugs before the laryngoscopy, because the laryngoscopy maneuver is very, very painful. So you can have a cerebral hemorrhage during laryngoscopy if you don't give opioids. And it's very, very important point, because in the past, there was this idea that we have to give opioids in pregnant woman during cesarean section until the cord clamp. Now it's ethically incorrect. So you have to do the drug, the opioid drugs to the mother before the incision, before the laryngoscopy. Because it's very, very important that she doesn't feel pain.
We don't do it yet. But I will, this video will go to my colleagues in their own time to see it. So we will discuss about this.
We had a case, not here, but in another city of Italy, very famous now, I think was in Bergamo. And they performed the general anesthesia without opioids in a clamp fixation. And she developed the cerebral hemorrhage. So, because you don't know if she has an arteriovenous malformation, like in the our second case. So if you have a very, very high blood pressure, you can rupture the malformation.
Thank you very much.
Okay, now we have 10 minutes break. And return here at 5:30. Okay. See you soon.
And so good afternoon to everybody. We start with a neonatal case. I promise you that in 30, maximum 40 minutes, we have finished this presentation. So I understood that among you, there are not a pediatrician, apart Irina, that is in Padua. And so I know that you are all gynecologists. I discovered this aspect. We will present the following case now. And so this is the story, the maternal history. A pregnant woman arrived at the obstetric department 10 minutes ago. And due to abdominal pain, blood losses from vagina, she was immediately admitted to the delivery ward. Cardiotocogram documented a fetal heart rate of 70 beats per minute without variability. And this is your field. And what the obstetric team decided? The obstetric team opted for an emergency cesarean section for suspected placenta brucio, and the neonatal team was alerted.
Now, due to abdominal pain and loss,
you can imagine
the
situation
in your
setting.
She was immediately admitted
so
to the delivery ward.
Everybody
cardiotocogram documented a fetal heart rate of 70 beats per minute without variability. Obstetric team opted for emergency cesarean section for suspected placenta abruption. Neonatal team was alerted. Do you want to know something about the history of the mother?
Yes, of course. Which is the gestational age?
Gestational age is 39 weeks.
Okay. Do you have an estimated weight?
The estimated weight is 4 kilograms.
Okay. Does she have fever?
No fever.
Okay.
In the last days of for the mother and at admission, no fever.
Okay. Is she COVID free?
Yes, she is.
Okay. When did she start bleeding?
She started bleeding a few hours ago.
Okay.
And when she was at home.
Okay. And will you perform the cesarean section under general anesthesia?
No, the cesarean section is planned as a spinal anesthesia from anesthesiologist.
Does she take any drugs?
No, she didn't.
Okay, perfect. That's all for the moment.
Thank you.
Okay, we check the infant warmer. So I check the TPS and the temperature. Julia.
Okay, this is the maternal history. If you were the obstetrician or the neonatologist in this case, do you could consider to do further question to the obstetrician? I know that neonatologists everywhere, every day, and for every newborn, have to give a lot of question to the obstetrician. I know that you don't like it always, but. Do you have a further question for the obstetrician if you were the one of the team of the neonatal team?
Maybe
the questions.
The blood pressure, if she had her pregnancy followed up with.
Okay, this is a good question, and so the blood is a question from the neonatologist, but is a very important question for the obstetrician, of course. Now, the blood question was good for the mother. And as neonatologist, one question that I could add to my obstetrics colleague could be, when the mother stopped to have the perception of the fetal movements, because in my head I want to know in the history of this baby, was it when the onset of the asphyxia occurred. A few minutes ago, his mother started bleeding 2 hours before, but maybe that the baby or the blood losses, I am thinking to the retroplacental hemorrhage, maybe that the baby or the fetus was already in a bad condition since a long time, not only in the last 2 hours. So my question for this mother, for the obstetrician, was did you had the perception that fetal movements disappeared in the last few hours, in the last few days? This could be an additional question to do to the mother. Okay, however, we move on, and we now we in a few seconds we see how the team organize the preparation. Or the first, when you are in the delivery room, as a neonatologist, we try to define the role of each member of the team. In this case, Marta, that is the team leader, decide to distribute the role.
Oxymeter and the suction inspiration system. Martina, the suction supported bag, and the material for intubation and drums.
Okay, wait, let's go.
In this case, the word distribution of the of the of the task for each participant, and now someone is Marta, for example, is working on the TPs, on the ventilator, on the ventilator or the equipment for ventilating the baby. She was involved in preparation of the saturimetry, while Ina was involved in the preparation of the rest of the material. The temperature also is very important. Okay. How do you, what do you think about this preparation? Is it correct? Is that can it be improved based on, I don't know, what is your feeling with this preparation? What we do in the delivery room, I don't know who has the responsibilities for the preparation of the equipment in your delivery room. But in our delivery room, we have the midwife that every morning prepare the checklist. But when we arrive in the delivery room and we are called there, we check again all the equipment by using equipment checklist. And so, for example, in this case, the three neonatologist, our pediatric resident in this case, could organize better this the preparation of the equipment. For example, following the equipment checklist, we have the worm, and so we have to prevent it losses in the baby in the for the newborn. So, the temperature of the delivery room. Do you have to switch on the infant warmer? To use warming. And so there is a long list based on the steps of neonatal resuscitation. The first minute that include warm, cleaning hardware, and evaluation. The second step is the ventilation, and that include face mask ventilation, intubation. And after the last part is chest compression and medication. And so I think that the preparation of the material could be done better, could be improved if you follow a checklist that guide us what to do. And so we cannot forget every step. And so every step is completed, followed, and checked. And so now we move on.
Yeah, you have the baby.
The baby is
what do you want?
Oh, yes.
Are you
sure? Yes, thank you.
Do you want to know the condition?
Oh, yes.
Is there it?
Does it cry?
No, it does not cry.
Does it cry? Yes. Okay, and how is the muscular tone?
Tone is hypotonia.
Oh, breathe?
Breathe, no breathe. Okay. It's up there.
Try him. Okay. Okay, we push this away. Okay. So, oxymeter. Stimulate. Okay. And does he have secretion on the mouth, on the...
Okay, when a baby arrives in immediately after birth, we consider three parameters that are very important. One is historical information, amnestic information. And so we ask to obstetrician, is the baby a term baby, a full-term baby? And the second question is the baby apneic? Is the baby crying or breathing? And the third question, how is the tone? Is the tone good? If you answer yes to all these questions, so full term, breathing or crying, and has a good tone, we leave the patient with the mother. And so in this case, it means that the baby is well. And so in this case, it does not need neonatal sedation. In this case, need to stay with the mother. In this case, I don't know if it's the same in your delivery room, but we strongly support the delayed cord clamping. I don't know if it happens in your.
Yes, it happens the same. We support strongly.
You wait, okay. What is the, how much time do you wait? 30, 60 seconds, 2 minutes until the absence of pulsation of the umbilical cord. What is your
1 minute time? 60 seconds.
How much, sorry?
60 seconds we wait.
Okay, the guidelines recommend at least 60 seconds or 1 minute. Wait at least 1 minute for delayed cord clamping. Okay, it is very important for the transition of the baby, for the iron stones during the infancy, for the hematocrit immediate after birth, and so for long-term outcome at 4 years of age. And so please convince all obstetricians and pediatricians to wait until 1 minute in the healthy newborn. However, this is not an healthy newborn because the question where is apneic? Yes. Is it breathing? No. Is the tone good? No. And so this patient was positioned at the infrared warmer, and now they are trying to move on with the situation. One question by Marta was, was no, and so now she decided to suction, to do the suction.
Does it break?
The baby.
No, it doesn't break.
Very nice. Okay.
The suction for the mouth and after the nose. His doctor is putting
okay.
And now we are checking the heart rate, that is very low, 50
minutes.
Now we are at 1 minute of life.
Tissue positive ventilation, starting
okay. The indication for starting ventilation are two at birth. The first is presence of apnea, it's better, they are three. Apnea or presence of gasping and heart rate less than 100. This patient is apneic, and this patient has a heart rate of 50 beats per minute, and so less than 100. So this patient has two indications for starting PPV. And we decide to start in PPV with this parameter. Room air and inspiratory pressure 25 at PEEP 5. But these are parameters that probably you don't know to remember, because this, your pediatrician knows them very well. Okay, now we move on. And so we start ventilation due to the apnea.
How is the saturation?
Bradycardia.
Saturation is not available.
Okay.
Saturation at this moment is not available because we are at 1 minute of life, and you need 2 minutes at least to have the saturation available in the healthy newborn. In this baby that probably is vasoconstricted in the peripheral area, probably we need more time. Okay. However, it's important.
Then we continue the ventilation. Okay. And that's the breathing?
No.
No.
The baby does not breathe.
Okay. And check the
apneic.
My rate is 5 beats in 6 seconds.
Okay. So, 50 again.
Do you have some comment in this part of the video? One very important statement is one of the most important statements in the textbook of neonatal resuscitation. The most important
is the baby breathing.
Please.
Is the breathing?
Sorry? Ventilation saves the baby, okay? And so the most important intervention during neonatal resuscitation is effective ventilation. This is the most important information. I can today I receive a phone, a call phone from a colleague from a peripheral hospital in severe asphyxia, and the anesthesia positioned the tube in the esophagus, and the baby did not recover it. Yesterday we received another baby from another from home, born at home, and again the baby did not recover because the tube was not in the right place. And so please, when the baby does not recover, you have to consider that you have done a mistake. You need to improve the ventilation. And what Marta did, Marta spent 30 seconds in not effective ventilation because you have not chest movements. And so now they try to solve the problem. They discover it.
Thank you, okay, we check our ventilation.
Yes,
okay.
The thorax is
not set moving.
Okay. So we have to do the research so far. So I put the repetition to the mask. Okay.
If you have not chest movements, you have that is acronym that is called Mr. SOPA that can guide you in improving your ventilation. The Mr. SOPA means mask, repositioning of the neck, of the head, suctioning, open mouth, increase the pressure, and alternatives. Now we see what our pediatric resident did.
Then I have
a secretion
to aspirate. I don't know.
No secretion, the mask, okay. The neck.
We have the mask, the coronary, the coronary air. Yes, yes. Yeah.
Does the thorax rise up?
No, the chest movement.
So I put the beep higher. Okay.
Here yeah, you can see that it's increased. The doctor is increasing the pressure. Okay, is another possibility to improve the movements of the thorax.
Okay.
Let's try again. Okay.
Rate 5 beats in 6 seconds.
Okay.
Yeah.
So,
thank you.
Today. Yeah, we have to.
And so they try to ventilate the baby, but as you have not effective ventilation, their heart rate remains very low, less than 60. You are in a very red zone, in very, very red area, okay? And so your baby is very sick in this moment. You have to solve the problem.
I prepare for the oxygen, and they prepare for intubation. So they decide to change the intubation. It is a reasonable choice.
In our institution, we put the tube via nasotracheal, nasotracheal intubation instead of orotracheal. Some question at this point?
I have a question.
Please. Okay, this is Fabrizio, a very good question. It's a question from anesthesiologist working with adults and with pediatrician. Okay, it is reasonable, but the reason of cardiac arrest in the newborn is asphyxia, hypoxia, apnea, primary apnea, and secondary apnea. From the secondary apnea, you can came out only with effective positive ventilation. The guidelines say that after 1 minute of effective ventilation or 30 seconds to 1 minute of effective ventilation, a rate remain low than 60, you can consider chest compression. But chest compression are not effective if you don't ventilate the baby. The pathophysiology of the cardiac arrest in the newborn is completely different from the adults and from the children. In the children and the adults, mainly in the children, and always in the adults, the reason, the pathogenesis, or the cause of cardiac arrest is a primitively a problem, a cardiac problem, while in the newborn 99% of the times is a respiratory problem. And so you have to achieve effective ventilation as soon as possible. And for this reason, now they are very concentrated in improving every step of ventilation. Now we see what they do. However, it's a very good question, Fabrizia. Okay, now we proceed with intubation.
Okay, I put it on 11 centimeters.
Okay. Another very important point is to lift distance.
Okay.
Distance. Okay. So you have to put the tube in the right place.
Okay.
Not in and the
move
the
air is symmetrical.
Yes, it seems to be symmetrical.
We wait and we check.
Oh, yeah. Is it the plate?
Heartbreak is 5 in 6 seconds.
5 in 6 seconds.
Heart rate is still very low.
Okay. So we have to do the doctor.
Okay. So I check the tube.
Perfect.
It is in the current way.
And so if heart rate is not improving, they try to understand if the tube was in the right position. And so we use the acronyms that is called a DOPES, that is dislocating means dislocation. And so now Marta is checking if the tube is in the right place. Obstruction, maybe the tube is obstructed. A complication of ventilation is the pneumothorax. And so P is for pneumothorax. Another P is for pressure. You can increase the pressure. E is for equipment. Maybe that your equipment does not work. And so please consider to change your equipment. And the last, the S in the DOPES is means the stomach. And so you can use a gastric or orogastric tube to take out the air in the stomach. Now she's working on this location. And so she check the where the tube, where the tip of the tube
yes.
is.
Yes, okay, perfect.
Okay.
Obstruction.
Obstruction
of the tube, we have secretion. Are there secretion?
No secretion.
Secretion, no, the tube is not.
Now we can
yes,
higher
the pressure.
If you want to continue.
Yeah,
so 40.
30.
Yes, okay. Check again.
That is a good idea.
On the correct position.
Now you have 5 minutes, and the heart rate is 5 beats in 6 seconds.
And in the sound are in the correct position.
Yeah.
Okay. We are going to check
the pneumothorax because
the
sound in the lateral area. Now they decide to check the equipment.
Okay.
So the E of the topes.
Is the thorax moving?
Yes, you have a very good chest movement.
Okay.
Very good chest movement. So now they have stolen the
Okay.
Please, go ahead.
Yes.
Okay.
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 Okay. Okay. Okay.
Okay.
Okay, the heart rate
is
part of the cases. Heart rate improve when you have we are giving positive pressure ventilation, apart from some circumstances, such as a placenta brucio, such as when you have a very important blood losses from the mother, like in this case. And so now they have solved the most important problem. They have achieve effective forced ventilation. Despite it,
the 5 beats in 6 seconds.
very
okay, good. Okay, we so we should start the heart muscles. Okay, to do this. And I will prepare for the implantation. And does we have gas analysis?
Okay, and now they decide to start chest compression. Now we are more or less at 6 minutes after birth. We are a little bit later because you have to, of course, to start in guidelines state that you have to start chest compression when you have achieved effective ventilation, but this time is more or less two to three minutes. Now we are 6 minutes, and so we are a little bit later. Now we see the synchronization between ventilation and compression.
Same gas coordinate the gas analysis of the baby.
Do you like? I know that I imagine that you have some experience in the courses, or at least the theoretical courses on chest compression. What is the problem? It is in the coordination between the two members of the team.
They go too fast?
No, really not. They don't go too fast, but the problem is that they are not coordinated, because you have to maintain a rhythm of 3 compression and 1 ventilation. 3 compression and 1 ventilation. And so 120 events in 1 minute. And so you have to be fast. You have to compress 1/3 of the anteroposterior diameter of the thorax. And so the depth of the compression is correct. Also the rate, if you want, but the problem is that they are not coordinated. This kind of chest compression can be done again in an adult, and also in the pediatric patient when you have intubated the baby, but for the newborns, Even when the patient is intubated, you have to maintain the 3-to-1 ratio. Why? Because ventilation is very important. So you need to optimize the ventilation. If you do the ventilation in the same moment with chest compression, the chest compression can obstacle. Can be an obstacle to ventilation. And so this is the improvement suggestion, okay. The suggestion for improvement of this procedure here. Okay. However, we come back, the patient is ventilated.
We put the umbilical catheter,
and we
will fix it around 4 centimeters.
Now they decide to put an umbilical catheter.
Okay, I check again.
From the umbilical cord.
No, we don't have
okay. I will try to perform it from
the rate is 5 beats in 6.
Okay. And the air is always symmetrical, the cord always in the... Okay.
I have the gas analysis.
Gas analysis.
Yes, thanks.
Now, okay. The blood analysis. Of life, yes. They ask the for a blood pH analysis. Is 6. Stop here. Is it late? Is it correct? Is it too fast? Or if you are a neonatologist, when do you want to have the blood gas analysis? Immediately after birth?
Immediately after birth, the first one at least.
Fantastic. Immediately after the birth is very important because you can understand what this baby has. What are we interested in this case? My question to the immediate postnatal blood gas analysis is this baby in acidosis? In addition, is it a respiratory acidosis or is it a metabolic acidosis? Because it does not change my algorithm or my intervention, but it gives me an idea where the baby is. Okay, if I have, like in this case, a severe
acidosis that is mixed. PCO2 is still high, 80 millimeter of mercurium, and I have minus 19 of base excess. And so here we are in a very severe mixed acidosis, okay? And so, correct. This team could ask for a immediate blood gas analysis to be sure how the patient, or how the condition of the patient were at the beginning.
Okay, mm-hmm. PCO2 is 18, mm-hmm. PO2 is 25, mm-hmm. Bicarbonate is 11, and the basal excess is minus 19.
How is the hematocrit?
The hematocrit is 20%.
Okay,
in this case, Julia asked for the hematocrit that can be found in the blood gas analysis, at least in our institution, in our delivery room. It is very important because the hematocrit in the newborn is at birth is 60%. And so it means that this patient had severe blood losses, okay? 2/3 of the blood are not in the patient. And so they were in the placenta, I don't know, in the vagina of the mother, but and so this patient had a severe hypovolemic shock in addition to a severe asphyxia.
Okay, so I start to do a bolus of saline solution, 10 milliliters per kilo, so I will do 30 milliliters, 35. Okay.
And so based on the hematocrit, this team decide to give volume expander to the baby. The dose, the posology is 10 milliliter per kilo. And so it is correct, the amount of volume. But
okay.
You have to give the volume expanders in 5 to 10
minutes. And that we can ask for blood transfusion.
We have zero negative.
Okay.
Blood.
We have a two elevator
here,
no? For
the group. Yes.
At the same time,
so
they
ask. So are you holding
the
blood? Blood.
You can use the zero negative.
Okay. Okay. The blood, okay. I'll finish the bonus. The bonus is finished. Actually,
you want to check again? Yes.
Rate is six. And I prepare another bolus of saline solution.
Yes, okay.
And so they have given the epinephrine.
Okay,
plasma expander.
Our rate is six.
And they are waiting for
six.
Okay, we do the second one.
They give time to the baby to recover.
The saturation is?
Saturation is 50%.
50, okay. Now we will do again 35 milliliters of air, okay?
And the thorax is moving correctly.
Thorax moving correctly.
Okay. So we can do a rapid breathing.
Yes.
So she's a 10 baby with the possibility of hypovolemic shock, hypovolemic for placenta abortion.
Yes.
Okay, so we did the intubation, okay, and the thorax is the movement are good. Okay.
So we did a good ventilation.
Okay. Two bolus, this is the second one.
Yes.
Of volume expander and one adrenaline.
Yes.
With the effect partial effect. Okay.
Okay. Okay, what the team is doing now? This is a very important point of this scenario.
They are reviewing what they have done so far.
Okay. The important thing is that they decide to stop the resuscitation and to spend a few seconds. There is an indication, a rule that means take 10 seconds for 10 minutes, okay? The Martina, in this case, she is our pediatric resident that was here, they decide to stop and she summarized for the team all the steps. We have intubated the baby, ventilation is effective, chest movement, they continue to ask for me. How is the chest movement? How are the chest movement? Chest movement are perfect. And so that is a solved problem. And after Martina told, okay, we have administered chest compression, second part of the algorithm, perfect. Another aspect that has been already done. Now they are in the red area of the resuscitation. That means we are in the drugs, the administration, medication of the drugs. And they decide we have given volume expander, the normal saline in this case, and we have given adrenaline. Remember that adrenaline has to be administered before volume expander, because you have a vasoconstriction, an alpha effect that has to be achieved before given volume expander, because we want to put the blood or the volume in the heart. Not in the rest of the body. However, remember the order: adrenaline first, volume expander later. And as the heart rate is still 60, they decide to give the second bolus of.
Check again. I will perform another blood test. Yes, rate is.
Heart rate is 7 in
okay.
6.
Okay, blood gas test.
And we continue.
Heart rate is over
6.9.
Okay.
So this CO2 is 60.
Okay.
CO2 is 30.
Okay.
Bicarbonate.
They forgot to ask for the blood gas analysis at birth, immediately after birth. And now in 2 minutes, they ask for 2 blood gas analysis. I know that adrenaline in the team is very high, but what are you expecting for the new blood gas analysis? You cannot change the blood gas analysis or the pH or the PCO2 in 2 minutes. You cannot change the metabolic acidosis in this case, because you cannot give bicarbonate in this baby. The bicarbonate was lost 10 years ago from the, was eliminated 10 years ago from the International Guideline on Neonatal Resuscitation. And so we don't give bicarbonate because bicarbonate increased the mortality when administered during resuscitation. And so please wait. You need at least 20 to 30 minutes to work on the only parameter that you can improve in the blood gas analysis, that is the PCO2. And so take your time. I know that you want to know blood gas analysis every minute, but it does not change in a short time.
It's 11 and the index is minus 19.
Okay, and the hematocrit?
Hematocrit is 20.
Okay, does the blood arrive?
Not yet.
We will perform another bolus. Okay. So maybe 20 milliliter, okay, yes, per kilo. So 70. Okay. 70. How many minutes?
Now they decide to give a third dose of
10 minutes.
Normal saline.
10 minutes.
It is very generous because the
cost is 10
minutes per kilo.
But ecco un pochino. No. We can. Okay. We should continue ventilation. Okay. I left the NICU. That's Okay. We'll arrive. We can switch off the temperature and start passive cooling because it could be an
associated. Now they decide to switch off the infrared warmer because you know that when we have a baby, an asphyxiated baby or baby with asphyxia, we offer
cooling,
okay? And in this case, it's passive cooling during the first minutes of life, but after you do the active cooling, okay? Active therapeutic hypothermia. And we maintain this baby for three days at the temperature between 33 and 34 degrees Celsius. Okay.
Okay. Okay. We start with the hypothermia. Okay, I check the bolus, finish the saline bolus. How is the frequency?
Her rate is, her rate now is 90.
Okay.
Let's continue.
Okay. We have a task about
the
fluid,
amniotic
fluid.
If
it is
at this point, is amniotic fluid normal or meconium stained? It's not so important, I think, because it is clear the pathogenesis of the asphyxia.
Normal or
the way they ask it, the color of the meconium. I don't know.
The blood.
Okay, very good.
Please start.
It is fusion.
Okay,
it is cold now.
Yes. Here. Okay, just a moment.
Do you need other information?
If the baby starts to
check again the heart rate,
to move or to have a minimal tone? No.
The tone is still hypotonic.
Okay, the breath?
The breath, no, apnoic.
Apnoic, okay.
Our rate is now is 11 in 6 seconds.
Okay, the blood transfusion.
Situation.
Okay, 20 milliliters per kilo, yes. Okay, and now I think that I can call for
the NICU.
Okay.
Call for the NICU and we transfer the baby to the NICU.
Okay, do you want to go to the NICU now?
Yes.
Bravo!
Do you have some question? Or are you interested in specific aspects? It was a severe asphyxia, of course, but.
We do hypothermia therapy in our hospital as well. We actually are one of the centers, the big centers in the country where we get these babies that come with asphyxia. I was wondering what is the therapeutic window for you? What your thought about xenon? I have seen in conferences that there are, for example, the Toby trial, I think, they used xenon for these babies as well.
Thank you for your question. And the therapeutic window is to start therapeutic hypothermia within 6 hours. Any more study show that if you start within 2 hours, cerebral outcome is a neurological outcome is better than to start at 5 hours. And so start as soon as possible. For example, when we cover an area with 22 hospital, 20,000 deliveries, and we also yesterday we have two severe asphyxia and we called it in two different hospitals. It's not all the days like this, but my colleague that was on call yesterday went into different city in our region, and when we went there, we have therapeutic hypothermia also during the transport, and so we have the devices to start the active therapeutic hypothermia as soon as possible. And so please start soon, avoid severe hypothermia, because when you do passive hypothermia without a servo control system, the risk is that you achieve also 31, 30 or 32 degrees Celsius. In this case, you can have severe asphyxia or severe pulmonary hypertension. So you have to be careful, but please start as soon as possible. Therapeutic, the use of additional drugs to the therapeutic hypothermia. Additional drugs such as xenon, such as other drugs, erythropoietin, for example, have been considered, but they are not standard of care now. And so we need more evidence to use them. And so unluckily, the only therapeutic strategy that we have now is hypothermia, that save the brain of one patient every seven to eight treated patients. So we cannot save all the patients. And it depends on the grade of asphyxia. If you have a severe asphyxia, SARNAT and SARNAT level 3, hypothermia is not so effective. While if you have a moderate SARNAT and SARNAT 2, it could be effective in a part of them, not in all of them.
Thank you. Can I ask one more question? I have the chance to have a specialist in front of me, so I would like to ask one more question if that's okay with you. Can I ask? Yeah.
Yeah.
Can I ask one more question? So why is the focus only on the brain for these babies? Because other organs, like the heart, the kidneys, they suffer too. Is it effective? Hypothermia is effective for these organs as well?
No, no, io non riesco a sentire la domanda. Avete capito voi? Are you asking if hypothermia may be dangerous for other organs?
No, no. Now
it's better. The volume is better. Please.
No. So I say that the focus has been mostly on the brain because of course, the risk of cerebral palsy. But with birth asphyxia, all the organs of the baby are suffering. The kidneys, the heart, the lungs,
the liver. Yes. The intestine.
Do we know if hypothermia helps other organs as well, apart from the blood? Or what means do we have to prevent multiple organ and system failure in these babies?
Okay, thanks again for the question. The problem is that when all the organs, apart from the brain, recover very well. The only organ that can be a problem, but may in general is a transient problem, are the kidneys, because you can have a renal insufficiency for a few hours or a few days. You need also the dialysis, come si chiama? The dialysis, okay? And so, we are concentrated on the brain because that is the main problem. Of course, we take care of every aspect. There is a protocol where you have to avoid hyperoxia, you have to avoid hypoxia in this baby, so you have to maintain the baby in the correct range of saturation between 19 to 95. You have to avoid, if you have, for example, a cardiac damage, you can have hypotension, and so you have to maintain the mean arterial pressure in a correct range, more or less 50 millimeters of mercurium. You have to avoid hypo and hyper capnia in these cases, because hypo and hypercapnia gives vasoconstriction or vasodilatation in the brain. Hypercapnia give also vasoconstriction of the lung, of the arterial pulmonary artery, so the risk is pulmonary hypertension. You have to avoid to give milk since the first day of life, and so the baby does not receive milk or nutrition for at least during the time when he's in hypothermia, therapeutic hypothermia. And so, of course, for example, if you have, you can have a blood problem, because you can have hemorrhage due to the platelet, reduced number of platelets, the coagulation could be impaired. And so many aspects to take care. But the most important information is all disaster can be solved. They can improve, they can recover. The problem is that we don't know how to recover the brain. So sometimes we decide to avoid extra therapy. I don't know, so to avoid to be too much aggressive, because we know that the prognosis is not so good in some of these patients. When electroencephalogram, the CFM, continuous functional monitoring, could give you good information, prognostic information. And we do also magnetic resonance at between 5 and 7 days for prognostic purposes. But the clinical aspects, again, are probably the most informative information, as always in medicine. Do you want to come here, the team? And so we say goodbye to everybody. Thank you. Please come. Abbiamo da mettersi la mascherina. Stringi, stringi. Irina, please.
Gira.
No, bella Irina, tira da te dentro, perché se no aspetta, spostiamo lui. Eccolo.
Thank you. Thank you so very much, everybody, for all your efforts. We really appreciate that you took your precious time these 2 weeks to explain us, and we are really, really grateful. I have learned so many things, honestly, from each of you, and I'm sure that because you gave us, and this I thank you again for, you gave us the opportunity to record this. We will give to our colleagues, and in their own time, when they have time, they will watch, and we will make a meeting in the hospital and discuss the points that you raised. And it is so beneficial for us. I really, really thank you. And again, these recordings will go to doctors that have participated in this project, about 600 doctors in the country. Neonatologists, anesthesiologists, obstetricians. We will give them these recordings, and they will watch, and they will learn. Because a big problem from our country is that we have a huge discrepancy, economical discrepancy, between big cities like this city of Bucharest and other places in the country. And in this project, we had doctors coming from all over the country, even from those areas that are less developed. So I'm sure that they will be very, very happy. And we will write to you, and I will send the feedbacks. I will ask them to fill feedbacks in, and then I will send them to you. So I'm really sorry we were not more people in the course, We had to be 13 participants. These are the selected 13 from the 600. These were the people. And but your message is will get around the country. I thank you very much. And I'm really, really, really grateful. I hope one day I can come and shake your hand and, you know, thank you in person. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you for your kind words.
Especially thank you to Irina that have organized the course with us. And next time in Bucharest,
it's a pleasure and an honor for me to make the bridge between so good professionals here and so good professionals there. So, yes, thank you, and looking forward for future collaborations.
Of course.
Of course.
Thank you very much. Thank See you soon.
Thank you.
Bye. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Bye. Bye-bye.